Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us. We're going to give everyone just a minute or two to get settled. Let everyone who might show up a minute or two late join us, and then we'll get started. Everyone joining us, we're just going to wait another 30 or so seconds to let people file in that may be showing up a minute or two late, and then we'll get started. All right. So welcome, everyone, wherever you are in the world. Thank you so much for joining us. We really, really appreciate it. We're looking forward to an exciting event. I'm here with Brittany Allen. We'll get into the introductions in a minute. But to start off, I just wanted to tell everyone a little bit about Merchant Fraud Journal, just in case this is the first time that you're joining us. We're an independent, unbiased publication. Dedicated to bringing you incredible content and thought leadership around the fraud prevention industries. We have an audience that stretches all the way from SMBs through to enterprise. And we have a number of different channels where you can find us if you're interested in interacting with us more. And we just recently released our 2023 Consumer Payments Survey Report, which is where we're going to get the data for this webinar presentation. So I'm going to drop a link to that in a minute or two in the chat so that everybody can download it and check it out. It represents a survey that we commissioned about consumer payments and some fraud indicators in that data. And we're going to talk about that here as well. So please feel free to check that out. And then on to the introductions. So this is me. That's the best picture of me ever taken. So that's that's as good as I look. Brittany is a trust and safety architect with Sift. I'm the co-founder and editor-in-chief of Merchant Fraud Journal. Brittany is a wealth of information about payments and security and customer experience. And we're really, really privileged to have her here on the webinar with us. So Brittany, why don't you introduce yourself and then we will jump right in.
I will do. Also, this would be one of the best pictures, at least recent pictures taken of me. This was immediately post haircut where someone else with much better skill set than I had styled my hair. So I'm thankful for that. But I am a trust and safety architect at Sift. And what that means is that I've spent a majority of my career as a merchant. I worked primarily in e-commerce marketplaces, getting my start at Etsy, then moving to Airbnb, working for a luxury marketplace called First Dibs, and then lastly at Letgo, which was secondhand sales. But I've also had a wealth of experience and really benefited from my 3+ years here at Sift of getting to talk to all different types of merchants and companies and seeing what kinds of fraud they are encountering. So hopefully I'll be able to bring some of my knowledge in today, but then also be able to share some of what I know from those conversations, et cetera. But I also want to make sure that people kind of know what Sift is too, just in case you are new to our name. So Sift is a leader in digital trust and safety, and we provide solutions for companies such as these to be able to tackle lots of different fraud challenges, whether that is at the point of payment, let's say with a stolen credit card, or at account takeover, which we never want to happen to any of our accounts. And we'll actually get into some of these fraud challenges throughout the webinar today. But it can also be used at the point of content, when you're posting information online. There's just so many different vulnerabilities that fraudsters can exploit. And that is part of our job to help merchants and help companies be able to prevent and mitigate as much as possible. So our agenda today is going to touch on that survey that Bradley introduced you to and also has already put a link to in the chat so you can read about what we're discussing in more detail and share that within your company. And we're also going to highlight a couple of payment fraud trends. These come from one of Sift's recent reports and will just sort of allow us to sort of further the conversation and build upon the Merchant Fraud Journal survey. And then lastly, we're going to walk through some steps of options for how merchants can adapt to these changes and to prevent fraud to protect your customers. We obviously can't go into all the answers, but hopefully by the end of our discussion today, you will have a solid takeaway or something that you can do to bring back and to improve your approach to fraud prevention. So without further ado, let's dive into the survey highlights. Now, we're going to go over these slides and Bradley and I are going to both speak to them and have some back and forth and really sort of analyze and hypothesize on the consumer responses and what we see within the data. But if at any point during this you have questions, please absolutely share those within Q&A. We really do want to be able to address those and have any interaction possible. I know that's tough when we're all still, logged in via Zoom, but if you have any questions that come up, please don't hesitate to ask. So let's start with the first section of the survey. It was on digital payment adoption and usage. And one of those questions that was posed was, how often do you make payments online? This is a good baseline to start from. And we really shouldn't be surprised that we see weekly and monthly up at the top responses. So people who are either comfortable buying every week or maybe just every other week or so go into the monthly category, but that's a sharp drop to people who either haven't adopted payments whatsoever online or who are also making it all day, every day with that daily column. I want to contrast that before we dive in a little more deeper with another stat from the survey, and that being that when asked, 85% of consumers responded that they have never made a payment using cryptocurrency. I am not surprised by that stat. There's a lot of reasons behind it. It can be because of the devaluation of most cryptocurrencies over the past few years as a crypto winter turns into what I've heard called a crypto ice age, but also just that it's not as easy for consumers to pay with cryptocurrency when they've already got online methods that they're using as frequently as weekly and monthly, as seen in this graph, that maybe don't have the same kind of fees for taking fiat currency and turning it into cryptocurrency, and still provide, and this for me is the most important part, still provide consumer protections that allow them to, let's say in the event of a problem, file a chargeback dispute or otherwise be able to receive some of their payment back and have to work with a merchant on that. I've fought chargebacks for over a decade. I know it's not fun, but as a consumer, I'm sure you could understand sort of the unwillingness to give up some of those protections. So I think these two graphs here together do show a strong adoption in online payments, but as far as using one of the most talked about alternate payment methods, crypto, it's not anywhere near that same volume. Bradley, is there anything that you'd call out here that I might have missed?
No, I think you said it really well that we have heard a lot of chatter in recent years about the shift to alternative payments. And while it's true that people have adopted digital payments and are comfortable buying things online, we are seeing that the death of the credit card, so to speak, has been greatly exaggerated. And I think that that is an interesting stat for merchants to keep in mind as they're developing their strategies.
I hate to put you on the spot, but didn't you say someone in your family has like a Diamond Hands t-shirt that they very much would fall into that category of of being someone who would not use the cryptocurrency as a currency just yet?
Yeah, my father-in-law, he has one because I bought him a Diamond Hands t-shirt, which he wears when buying and purchasing stocks online. But yes, he is definitely not a crypto user either.
I love it. That's great. I need to get one of those. All right. So let's jump into the next stat. This one's from the section of the report on consumer attitudes towards digital payment methods. So we see here that 94% of consumers stated they had completed a purchase online in some capacity. And also 12% of respondents who noted that they exclusively use online channels. And then the third stat off the side asking about chargebacks. We'll get to the chargebacks in a minute. But right now I want to compare that 94% and then the 12%, because I find this to be compelling. So 94% of the responders say they've bought online. So they're experienced with it. They have done it before. They have then the means to purchase online. But 12% noted that they exclusively use online channels. That's quite a low percentage. And I don't think it represents the number of people who would like to exclusively use online channels, or at least more frequently use online channels, but just those who are able to. And when thinking about what might prevent somebody from being able to make exclusively online purchases, you know, it all comes down to infrastructure. I live in New York City, and I could potentially get away with this. I could buy my groceries online and have them delivered to me. I could, you know, pay via a wallet, via my phone for every, you know, in-store purchase, or I could do something in a way where I would not be pulling out a physical card at a point of sale machine. But just a few weeks ago, I was visiting some family back in a very rural town in North Carolina, where the town does literally have one stoplight. And that stoplight is new to the past 10 years, by the way. And there is no way at their grocery store that they could buy online. Maybe they could with a wallet, but the last time when I was in there, I didn't see much updated hardware for that POS device. And then especially at the gas station, there was still only an old, you know, machine that would allow you to insert a credit card. There was no way to pay just because those machines had not been updated. Whether or not that's something that's going to come soon, it's just that they are in a very small corner of the world. And so even if they had the interest, they wouldn't have the ability. And I don't think until that infrastructure supports all online payments that it'll, you know, kind of get to that point. And of course, I'm not making a real distinction here between buying something completely online and not being in a physical location. But if it was to even just be buying everything online, then of course they would be, you know, completely shut out of that as well. Then to comment on the chargebacks, I was a little bit shocked that the yes was lower than the no, because as a merchant who has fought chargebacks for so many years, I just thought, well, surely everyone has filed a chargeback by this point, because even I, you know, someone who's had to deal with them and be on the merchant side, I have even filed chargebacks. Now, granted, I will do so only as a last resort. I have a rule where I have to try to reach out to customer service at least twice. I do try to do my due diligence, which is why I have also won all of my chargeback disputes, because they've only been when I was at the end of a row. But I really expected it to be at least even, if not more, in the yes column. And Bradley, you were saying the same with you?
Yeah, we were very surprised by this number, especially because we see it through the eyes of the fraud prevention community. But I think the key takeaway here is we've been harping, I think for a decade, on the idea that you turn away a lot of good customers when you are too afraid of chargebacks, and that what you really need to be doing is having models set up that will effectively find the bad transactions, but let through the good transactions. And so when we're looking at this question of basically, are you filing fraudulent chargebacks? I expected it to be higher because we hear a lot of conventional wisdom about this. And I think it really drives home the point that we have to put our emotions aside when we talk about these things and really dig into the numbers. Now, granted, this might be different for any specific merchant or any specific vertical for sure. But I think that this data is a good impetus for any merchant to really dig into what they're seeing in their data about just how many customers are actually weaponizing chargebacks, because I think it's probably less than most people think.
No, and that does raise a good point. So when you're specifically talking about fraud chargebacks, and this question asked the consumer, did you file one? I'm wondering if consumers don't necessarily see bank initiated chargebacks, like those that are, let's say, filed against fraudulent purchases that were made with their card when their card had been stolen, as ones that were even chargebacks. They just might see that as, well, that was, you know, consumer protection. That was my bank just refunding me. It certainly wasn't a purchase I made. They might not have been thinking in their head that that is a chargeback that they quote unquote filed. If it was just them working with their bank to identify, you know, fraudulent purchases on a stolen credit card. So it could also be terminology based. It could also just be their familiarity with how the process even works.
Very true.
All right, so let's move on to the third point. In this one, we're covering the section of consumer attitudes towards security. So one question was, what is your primary concern when using digital payments? And options were provided, including security, fees, privacy, availability, and of course, a catch-all other category. And by and large, security was the top ranking response. 44% of respondents listed security as their primary concern when using digital payments. What this says to me, and also what I want to call out, is that focusing on security and reassuring your customers that their payment information will be held securely or will be processed securely through your platform is something that you must focus on. But also, you need to understand and know that trust is not binary. There is not just a, you know, yes or no response to whether or not a customer decides to trust a website. To give you an example of that, let's call out let's use a social media platform. And just because they're huge, let's use Facebook as an example. So someone who has been years ago, let's go, you know, maybe a decade ago, someone who has been a regular user of Facebook and trusts them at that point with their photos, maybe with messages, with friends, with communication, with all that social media side. Let's say then when Facebook Marketplace comes up and then maybe you're able to add a payment method to that platform, they may have pause, not necessarily because they don't trust the platform at all, but because that then adds sort of another layer. And we see different types of data that we share online as either being ones where we're a little bit more concerned about the security or a little less concerned. I use Facebook as that example because you can also set all of those photos to be completely public, all of those comments to be completely public. But of course, we would never allow a consumer to turn on any sort of public setting for their payments or for any other sensitive PII. So that trust isn't binary. And when it comes to payments, I'm not at all shocked that a biggest concern would fall into that security category because of that.
Yeah. And when we were looking at this, I mean, call me cynical, but honestly, we would have assumed that fees probably would have been the most important. And if not, it would have been really, really close. And the fact that security just, you know, by far and away was the biggest concern really, really drove home for us this idea that this is on people's radars. It's not something that businesses can get away with not educating their consumers on anymore. They have to be communicating out to them what they are doing to protect them, to protect their data, and to ensure that it doesn't fall in the hands of fraudsters and other malicious actors on the web. And I think that that's also something that maybe the industry or businesses in general are less aware of, not the back end of we need to protect this because they're increasing regulatory liabilities behind that. And everybody knows what happens if there's a massive breach and you end up in the news. But I think that other side of the coin of, are you projecting out to your customer base, to your audience, that you take security seriously beyond just saying, oh, we have a security policy, but really building that trust and building that sense of confidence and partnership with them that you will be there for them when it comes to security issues.
Yeah, and there was a survey that Sift had done at one point, and I'm going to apologize in advance. I think I might get the number slightly off, but I believe roughly 1/3 of consumers responded saying that they would not use a brand again, would not purchase via a platform if their account was compromised. There's plenty of alternatives in most cases where they can find, you know, someone else to buy their tennis shoes from or whatever they're searching for. But it was at least 1/3, if not more. And so knowing that they prioritize their security enough that they'd be willing to, you know, abandon shopping from a particular brand is also something that this data backs up. All right, let's stay on security for a little while longer and look at the question, what is your preferred method of securing online accounts that house payment information? So a significant part of that question is preferred, not most commonly used, or any other question about that. But what do you, the consumer, you know, from what you know about security, prefer? And in this case, two-factor authentication came out on top, with 40% of respondents listing 2FA as their preferred method, followed closely by password only. So we see we've got two sides of a coin here, where the majority of respondents would be okay with a certain level of friction because they know of the additional benefit that adds. While then the second most common response was, you know, password only, I just wanna be let into my account, make this easy for me. However, if you then also look across to the other responses of security questions and biometrics, you do see that a vast majority have at least preference of some sort of friction. Now, my question here as a former fraud manager and somebody who is, you know, still steeped in the world of fraud is I wonder if all of those respondents who prefer 2FA are aware of the different options of 2FA that can be offered, whether that is an SMS code, whether that's an authentication app, et cetera, and if they're aware of the vulnerabilities that are targeting the, or that can be targeted within those methods, specifically by social engineering. So calling out one big example of a tool that is readily available on the deep and dark web, that would be OTP bots or one-time password bots. And that allows a fraudster to target a consumer via their phone number. This is somebody whose account information they already have and they're attempting to log into their account, but they do need to pass that 2FA that this consumer has opted into. And so they generate the code from the website that is then sent to the consumer's phone. And then they also simultaneously have this OTP bot call that consumer or message that consumer. There are multiple options and pretend to be the real place that consumer should enter the SMS code they just received to try to say, you know, don't go to the website, but they do say, hey, this is where you need to enter that code you just got to secure your account, not to say to let the fraudster log in, obviously. But I here now wonder if they are really aware of the advances that fraudsters have had in targeting that 2FA, because what I'm getting back to is my primary point on that little fraud tangent, is that fraudsters go where the money is and they also follow consumer behavior. And so if consumers really do prefer 2FA as their primary security method, that's gonna be the one that fraudsters have to focus on and find vulnerabilities in so they can get around it. And I've already heard some data that is being collected by the card networks on how many people or fraudsters are able to convince people to bypass this exact sort of verification in relation to SCA requirements in the EU. So it is something that we know is happening and we'll learn more about as that data continues to come in. Anything else? Oh, yeah, sorry. There you go, Brad.
Yeah, I was going to say on our end, what we were really surprised by in this data is, again, this idea that the higher friction method is preferred, because the conventional wisdom, again, is that people do not want any kind of friction. We hear a lot of talk that you have to basically just all but open the gates to people. because they'll go buy their widget elsewhere. And what we're finding tangentially, and I know we have one more data point after this that we're going to discuss, is that that's really not strictly speaking true. And that's not to say you shouldn't be providing excellent customer journeys and experiences, because of course you should be, but it just reinforces once again the point that people are aware of this. Security does matter to them. When you're asking them, what do you prefer? I think with hearing what you're saying, Brittany, and knowing in our positions in the fraud world, all the different ways that people circumvent these security measures, I think in the popular vernacular, so to speak, or the popular consciousness, when you hear 2FA, you think, oh, it can't be hacked, right? Because they're going to send me a thing on my phone, or they're going to send me an authenticator app. And so it can't just be hacked, right? And I think people probably equate that in the popular mind, again, with some sense of invulnerability. And so I think, and I don't know this for sure, but I would have loved to been able to talk to people live. I feel like you would have had to have a conversation with them about why they feel like two-factor is preferred, as opposed to something like biometrics, which I think in general is more secure, as a general rule. And I think the data scientist part of me is saying I'd need to ask people, but kind of the gut feeling that I'm having working in the industry is that people just feel like 2FA is more secure and less invasive. And so it's fine. But I would have expected to see password, again, winning, or even winning by a large margin. And the fact that it's not indicates that there is awareness now around the need for some type of security measure beyond the traditional password.
Well, you're just building the next survey. Always build upon the data that we've collected, and let's learn more. So let's get to that last data point that we're going to touch on: security and consumer friction. At this point, the question was, how often has experiencing friction when making an online payment, such as encountering a CAPTCHA, having to do email or SMS verification, caused you to abandon the transaction? So we've got a few times as our highest response, but it's also interesting to call out that second tier in never, which is the data point highlighted to the right, that 37% of respondents have never abandoned their transaction due to online payment friction. Now, me personally, I would fall into the a few times, because not necessarily because I don't believe that any of these points of friction are necessary, but I have just, you know, I'm a human and I can be lazy. And there have been a few times where I've been trying to purchase something on my laptop and it wants me to go to my phone and my phone is not with me, and I just don't purchase it. Maybe I intended to go back later and purchase it, but then I got, you know, enough time to think about it. Do I really need this t-shirt? Do I really need this new handbag? And I just didn't go through with it. Maybe I still would have had some regret in the moment and wouldn't have, you know, completed the order. But yeah, I fall into that a few times category. And there will be people who always, you know, temporarily abandon it just because in that moment, they're not able to complete the process. But I do want to make sure we're all seeing that the regularly column is very small. And that represents the diehards, those who, when they encounter this point of friction, are done with buying on that website. I don't know how they manage to buy some things then. It feel like every time I buy a plane ticket, I get sent through authentication. So I guess I wouldn't be able to travel anywhere, but apparently there are some people who can hold that line as toughly as they are, but it is a really small number. And I think that speaks against some assumptions that we made and things that we've already discussed so far and that Bradley alluded to on the prior screen about always assuming customers hate all friction.
Yeah, I really was shocked by this number as well. I really thought, and certainly the never number definitely shocked me. And it really does just show you that even when people are reporting back about when they have abandoned. So I feel like we have a really good set of data points here that tell a very consistent story. Any one in isolation might be kind of suspect, like, okay, let's see if that's really what's going on because it's running counterintuitive to what we would expect. But I think when you look at this series of data points, that's just constantly showing that security is important to people. People are using 2FA as their, or reporting 2FA as their preferred method. They are not abandoning, or very, very rarely abandoning, and almost no one is regularly abandoning transactions when they run into friction. When you see these data points, they just start to reinforce a general narrative that security does matter to people. And I think that's a shift, Brittany, from maybe even just 5 years ago. I think there's much more awareness. I don't have any data to back that up, but just anecdotally throughout the years, I feel like in the past, we would have spoken a lot more about the need to educate consumers on why these things are important. Whereas now the need is more to educate consumers that you actually have them in place. Yeah. And I find that interesting.
Yeah, I won't have all of the answers, but I can throw out a few of my own personal thoughts on that. I think part of an increasing comfort level with encountering friction for security also just has to do with the fact that now more and more platforms, or more and more ways you will use your money online, are requiring that security. So you have to deal with it. You have to have 2FA, for example. You have to upload an image of your government issued ID and take a selfie to be able to make some financial transactions. If you're required to do it, then you will, over the course of doing it again and again, you kind of establish some sort of acceptance of that. A good analogy would be a comparison point in, I believe, the 70s or so, roughly, when we were really encouraging people to wear seatbelts and the change shifted. And I probably got my decade wrong. I'm just trying to picture when my grandparents' cars and how old those were and which had seatbelts and which didn't. But there was a shift from seatbelts not being required to them being mandatory. And then a lot of effort put into getting people to buckle up and actually accept you need to wear the seatbelt, even though it was there and it was became part of a law. There's going to be resistance at first, but I do think when communicated with an understanding of what the benefit is on the other side, we're not just taking your ID and selfie because we want more data and information about you that we're going to exploit or going to sell or going to use in a way that you might be worried about. We're doing it to keep your account secure. That is something that more people are understanding. That's at least my take on it.
Yeah. And I would agree with that. I would still say, I think it's interesting that the 2FA thing really surprised me, right? Because there are other methods that I think are less onerous, specifically face or fingerprint recognition. And you're right. I don't know how much of that is just because maybe some of these methods are not available to people that don't have smartphones and things like that. But I think the amount of friction that people are willing to tolerate, not all friction is created equal, and the amount of friction that people seem to be willing to tolerate right now really surprised me. I'm curious what you think the best way to message this out to consumers is, because it's definitely a fine line between education and fear. And you know, saying we have all these methods requires you to kind of explain why they're there, just in the nature of your literature, because there will be some people that don't know. So I'm curious if you've ever worked with any merchants or have just your own thoughts about what you think is important to include when you're messaging this out to your audience.
I definitely have. I've been a merchant making those decisions, working with a marketing team, for example, that needs to put the final rubber stamp of approval on the email that we would send out when we had a suspicious login on a customer's account. And they were very worried about it you know, mentioning fraud too much or seeming to be too alarmist, while we were also saying, yes, but we do need to, you know, communicate what happened and some of the seriousness of it and let them know they need to report it to us if this was not them logging in from this new location. And so I've been part of that balancing act, and I really have a lot of admiration for companies that are willing to put the consumer education out there and aren't instead thinking, oh, if I mention fraud, they'll just think my entire company is, you know, is seeped in fraud and that there's so much fraud in our marketplace. Because I'm always an advocate for consumers being able to learn more. Now, where it gets to be a more difficult conversation is, how much is that visible? Is it a pop-up? Is it a warning, let's say on social media or a messaging platform, that, you know, the message that you were just sent seems to be a scam? Like, how sort of invasive in the customer experience is it? That's a call that those companies need to make individually. But just to answer the question about, you know, consumer education, I think that it is something that's necessary for the brands to put out, you know, in their own words, to share with their own customer base.
Yeah, I would agree. And I think we need to reconceptualize a little bit about what we're actually communicating there, because even though we're using on the surface words like fraud and theft, really what we're really messaging is, hey, we're paying attention and we're watching out for you. And I think that if you put that message across, however you choose to do that tactically, that that's going to be well received. I think that's, to me, that was the biggest takeaway from this entire report and, mm-hmm. and survey, was hiding it is not only not necessary, I think we've moved into a place where it's become detrimental mm-hmm. if you're not leading out with, we have your back here.
Totally agree. And as we move into the next section on payment fraud trends, I do have some data that goes along with the report and backs up some of what we're seeing. But I very quickly want to say, I just Googled it, and the law mandating seatbelts in the United States passed in 1968. I was so close with 1970. All right. All right. So again, some of this data comes from both the Sift network and some consumer surveys that we've done in the past. And I think it's great to show, you know, both sides, payments and fraud, sort of speaking to that same story, especially if those worlds blur together more and more year over year. So at the top, we've got some data comparing 2022 to 2021 to look at the increase in payment fraud rates across key fintech subverticals. I call this out because of that extremely large increase in buy now, pay later. Yes, buy now, pay later itself really took off and exploded over the past 2 years, but it had existed for a much longer time. I remember working with a particular buy now, pay later provider at least, oh gosh, I guess it was 6 or 7 years ago at one particular merchant I worked for. They've been options for, and it's actually probably longer than that. Time is a flat circle now that we're all still remote working from home. But anyway, that is something that fraudsters have been really targeting in on because they know it has increased in popularity. And one of the unfortunate scams that I had seen doing some of our deep and dark web monitoring here at Sift was fraudsters who would sell access to email accounts, knowing that they had verified that email account belonged to a person who had multiple buy now, pay later accounts, was potentially overextending themselves through all of those accounts, but at the very least had many options. And that was how they were selling access to buy now, pay later, where you only had to know information about one identity because they had at least, let's say, 6 different providers that were all tied to this one email. Going down to the other data there showing rise in global payment fraud, that just backs up that fraud continues to increase. But what I want to call out that I think it ties back to that data point on 2FA now being preferred and sort of catching you off guard, Bradley, and you thought it would be, you know, password only, is let's look at consumers who become repeat victims. From that survey that Sift had asked, 43% said they'd recently fallen victim to payment fraud. And of those who had fallen victim, 62% said that they'd experienced payment fraud between 2 and 4 times. I'd heard a stat years ago that said in somebody's lifetime, they will probably have their identity stolen, which means any part of your identity used, you know, PII, your payment method, whatnot. at least 6 times in their lifetime. And I don't know if that number is something that has increased now with the ways that we're able to interact online even more. But as people become repeated victims, you do have to reach some sort of point where you say, all right, you know what? What can I do to stop this? So that could be something that is driving people to be more security aware, since it seems like, you know, it's at least 2/3 of people roughly have experienced their information being stolen multiple times. How do you think that ties with that 2FA stat?
Yeah, I think it's really interesting. And something else I wanted to add here is this stat both surprised me and didn't surprise me. I think on the surface, it's easy to say, wow, 62%, like, what is the instant thought is, well, what are these people doing that they're leaving information so vulnerable? But I think that that's not really accurate. It's really more that once your information is out there, it's easier for hackers and fraudsters that are talking all the time on the dark web and in other places to say, hey, we have this information, it's working. So they're going to keep using it until they can't use it anymore. So I think what's interesting here is kind of looking at this from the perspective of remediation, and specifically in the context of the merchant's role in that, is this idea of the network, which I know is something that Sift has a gargantuan network of merchants, and being able to flag outside of your specific silo and your specific company, and being able to get information from outside of your ecosystem about what's going on with this type of fraud and with identity theft. And I think that that's something that's absolutely crucial now. The idea that you can be a purely do-it-yourself fraud prevention team now in 2023, I think is completely dead. That's what this stat says to me. You have to have eyes on the whole network, or as much of the network as you can get your hands on through a company like Sift that is working with thousands and tens of thousands of merchants, so that if something happens in one place, you will be aware of it. And I think that that's just an absolute must have now.
Agreed. And before we move on, I think it's easiest to answer Jennifer's question in the Q&A on this slide. So with that rise in global payment fraud, the difference between the 27% for all digital goods and services and then 64% focusing on B2C, the call out there is exactly what you said. The top category also includes B2B and other types of digital goods and services, but we wanted to make that distinction because we do find, and you know, it's unfortunate to say this, but I am also a consumer. So I guess, you know, I'm part of this problem I'm about to describe, but really the customer is the weakest link, is the biggest vulnerability that fraudsters will focus in on when, for example, they do those social engineering attacks, or when you make decisions about not implementing security, not being able to keep, you know, everything online protected. And so we wanted to call out that when you just boiled it down to business to consumer, so let's think of a physical goods retailer or something where a company is just selling to consumers and not to other businesses, yeah, we're going to see the biggest increase in that bucket. And that's because of the increase in online fraud that has been targeting consumers and trying to get within their accounts and to take advantage of their lack of knowledge or, you know, anything within that vulnerability that the consumer represents. All right. So I also want to call out the idea when we're talking about fraud and we're sort of merging, you know, fraud and payments to then only look at types of payments. There's a lot that goes into that that is complex. Maybe you work at a company where you are focused on payments and you're focused on loss, but maybe you aren't involved in operations or in the customer service department or wherever the refunds live. Refund and return fraud that results in loss that was not, you know, legitimately making a customer right when something wrong happens. When it is tied back to fraud, that is a part of payment fraud, even if at the end of the day, you, the merchant, are willingly sending the money back to the, you know, original payment method, you're doing the refund. that is something then to keep in mind. And there's a lot of different points here that we could dive into. Maybe these are points for additional conversations or conversations that we have in future webinars. But I also just want to call this out. We got to think beyond just traditional credit card fraud when we focus on payment fraud. And then lastly, I wanted to give this view here of a fraud as a service, step-by-step walkthrough of a particular scam unfolding on the deep web. These screenshots are basically representative of communication that we will see within fraud groups, within sites like, let's say, like Telegram, and shows how fraudsters will take something that they've stolen, in this case, a gift card, and then put it online and sell it for a steep discount against the value that is on the card. And that is something that can be discussed in fraud forums, but also can be sold to legitimate consumers, whether that's on a marketplace via social engineering. So we'll see a lot of blurring between people who may see a deal that looks too good to be true, but still take advantage of it and not realize they're participating in fraud. And then others who might see a heavily discounted gift card for sale online on a legitimate website and immediately know, oh, that's probably not legit. That might be, funded by a stolen payment method, but I know that I can probably redeem it and that I won't get in trouble. And my purchase will still go through regardless of how this gift card was funded. There is a spread of knowledge within consumers where when we're talking about the concept of the democratization of fraud, people are becoming more familiar with what they can do online that sort of goes into a gray area and makes them potentially more and more willing to participate in fraud. So a call out from years ago could be that idea of, I think that movies are overpriced or going to the theater is overpriced, or I don't want to pay this out of the other. So, or they don't make this TV show available online anymore. So I'm going to go pirate it. And people's approach to, you don't pay the artist very much for this music anyway, so I'm going to pirate it. People will come up with justifications for taking actions that we know aren't legal, but still kind of seem to go into this gray area and may or may not be more acceptable to certain people in certain places. And that is something that we're also seeing with payment fraud, some call outs being things that are lower dollar value or, well, I don't want to derail and get into too many particular examples. I think we can just stick to the lower dollar value and also the gift card. But I did want to bring that example out because now you've got behaviors that are very similar between legitimate, trustworthy consumers, and then maybe some of those who know that they are participating in a fraudulent activity, but don't really care, down to those who are the perpetrators of said fraudulent activity. And they're all coming to your platform in a varying degree. So I'm happy to answer questions about that. We can go into kind of more detail if we have time, but I wanted to make sure with the last minutes that we have together that we make sure to still touch on an example of how merchants can adapt. And this is going to focus primarily on the ideas of friction and customers remaining secure, because that is what we ended on with looking back at that survey data and seeing was such a priority for our customers. So let's start with a user on your platform and let's look at an example of going through a dynamic friction flow. So when this builds out, this is reflecting the Sift score. So on Sift, there will be a score tied to certain events within a customer's journey. And the lower the score, the better, just to explain what we're looking at. Obviously, green means go, so that's a good sign. So let's say in this instance, the individual logging into their account from a device that we already know, everything looks good. Maybe they've added a gift card to their account, but it's a very low value gift card. And then also nothing seems suspicious yet within that flow. So we're not challenging them with friction. The opposite of that would be having to have some kind of major challenge at the point of login, a major challenge to add a gift card or another payment method to their account. that is something that you might need to consider if there's a regulatory requirement for you to do checks at certain steps. But here we're looking at that idea of it should be fine in this case to then allow them to enable one-click redemption and to be able to proceed with a purchase because of all of the signals that we're looking at that let us know there's nothing yet to be suspicious about this activity. It's also really great to be able to pull data from the listings and the items that they look at on your website. I've seen fraudsters plenty of times log into a account and then immediately go to an item listing without any way that they could have found that item. They didn't use the search. It wasn't on the homepage. They already knew what they were going to target and what they were going to purchase with this compromised account. But, you know, browsing around is something that we wouldn't consider as risky until they change the email address. And then just to throw it in and make it even more complicated, then they're going after an item, let's say in our electronics marketplace, that is heavily targeted by fraudsters, and that is a phone. So at the point of them changing that email, we have increased the score because that is that risky signal. And it put us in a sort of medium category, but then we've crossed over to that threshold of a known fraud pattern when they're ordering the iPhone. Now, the great thing about this is we could have taken the action just at changed email. We can get ahead of the card actually being charged. And I want to call that out as something that's really important because I want you to think about what your restoration method is at your company for ATOs. What can you restore within an individual's account that makes it look like it was when they last logged in and not, let's say, walking into a home that has been burgled and vandalized and things are strewn about? What can you reverse within accounts and restore so that they don't have reminders and indicators of that ATO? And maybe the transaction is not something that you're able to do that with, because you can't, let's say, cancel orders or remove a canceled order from an account. You can't take it out of their view. And so let's get ahead of whatever we aren't able to retract so that the customer isn't constantly reminded of that lapse in security, which from their point of view will be a lapse in security. But let's say it does get to that point of them authorizing that order. We've got lots of options here. So you can see it's dynamic from beginning to end, and you really need to consider how that fits into your user journey and to also be able to QA this, see what works, get feedback. But you can cancel the order, you can send that 2FA authentication, you can push them through biometric authentication, or you can authorize, which we wouldn't do in this case, but let's just call out that that's some sort of example here. So with that, we want to make sure that it's part of your growth solution. And I want to leave with this framing because it is all about growth. For so many people within fraud prevention and trust and safety, we get told that we're the revenue killers. We just cancel orders. We just stop customers from getting the items that they deserve. Yeah, not really. What we do is we keep the platform safe. We make sure that people out there don't associate our brand with fraud. You don't want the first time a consumer has ever heard your brand name be when they get an alert on their phone or on their credit card statement when they see a fraudulent charge. So we're actually focusing then on maintaining the brand, protecting your business, and, you know, striving growth, not focusing, let's say, the efforts of your company onto accounts that won't have a good lifetime value because they're actually fraudulent. So consider this, these options when it comes to how you approach friction with your users. Keep in mind that some of our assumptions should be changed as far as how open to friction customers are willing to be, but definitely take a step back, consider how this fits into your user journey and what you're able to implement. And that is the end of it from me. And I think we're ready to dive into any questions unless you have anything else you want to add, Bradley.
No, that was all really good advice. And I would encourage everyone to reach out. And as I said at the top, Brittany is a wealth of information. And so please, anyone, if you have any questions, I'm sure she would be happy to to talk to you about it after the webinar as well. We do have a few questions right now. The first one is, what are the details around BNPL fraud, meaning the features around it and the vulnerability points that you're seeing with that?
So I can give a few examples. So I did already mention that idea that people who, unfortunately, are very much in need of having that credit extended to them to be able to make installment payments on more expensive items are therefore also people who might, you know, kind of over-leverage themselves. So the vulnerability can just come from sort of that user base with education there, or with knowing basically how to spend safely online. But when it comes to just fraudsters, let's say signing up and using BNPL accounts, not taking ATO into consideration at all, we'll basically see them be able to take payment methods that have smaller lines of credit and use them then to be able to purchase items of a much larger value. So if I've got a stolen credit card and it's only got $1,000 worth of credit on it, but I sign up and I use it on a through a BNPL payment method, and I then can buy a $4,000 item because I'm only making that first installment payment. I'm never coming back to the site. I'm never paying again. Obviously, I'm just going to get the item and be done with it. Then that made that credit card much more valuable for me as a fraudster. And the vulnerabilities do differ, you know, from provider to provider, or for how the providers work with various merchants. But one interesting thing I had seen in the past was one particular buy now, pay later provider had advertised that they would defer the first installment payment for 30 days. And whatever they were doing, I don't know these details, but whatever they were doing with the credit card, they were not properly authorizing it in advance of that first installment payment that would come on day 30. So what fraudsters were discussing and selling as a method was to go through, buy with this buy now, pay later provider using a credit card that was already dead. So one that had already either expired, you know, been reported as lost or stolen. These were known dead fulls that they were selling. And they were using then those dead credit cards, which have a pretty limited use for fraudsters, to be able to make these orders, because all that particular BNPL provider was validating was that the card had the right format and, you know, fit the bill for as far as a card that existed, but they weren't trying to authorize it to see if it was still a valid operating payment method. And that one exploded for a while until I believe the provider did fix it. So they will test and find little vulnerabilities like that, but the primary one being able to extend the usefulness and get more out of a card with a lower credit limit.
All right. Well, Brittany, we're getting a lot of people taking me up on my offer to talk to you. You'll be excited to know. So we have another question. What are industry standard approval rates? If you can share figures from multiple industries, that would be great. What is an acceptable chargeback rate, i.e. what should be the benchmark?
I'll start with the chargeback answer, because that's one that just is more within my wheelhouse as having worked on the fraud side. And I would say, first of all, your absolute ceiling would be the thresholds from the card networks that will get you penalized, the ones that will put you into monitoring programs or otherwise affect your ability to accept credit cards. Those can be around 0.7%. It escalates into, I think, 0.9% can officially push you over the edge for a Visa. But obviously, that is something to stay far, far away from. I would not recommend a floor necessarily, other than I want you to try to strike the balance of having the lowest possible chargeback rate you can, while still not over indexing on insulting legitimate customers. I could tell you to try to get down to, you know, 0.05%, but if for your business, that's not something that you can do in this moment without greatly, let's say, increasing the amount of orders that you block or reject, to the point where you're not able to QA or you aren't certain about how you can assess if there's insulted customers within that bucket, don't aim for that number. Now, that said, there is definitely ways that your chargeback rate can be reduced, and that would need to have a little bit more information and take more of a dive into what you're currently seeing. And then to go to that authorization or acceptance rate, Unfortunately, I don't have that information, but I would say look at some of the industry resources that are published in the payments world. There are quite a few available, like via the papers and digital transactions and also the Merchant Risk Council. There might be a number there. I would hate to misquote something and be inaccurate.
All right, we have two more. So I know we're right up against the time here, but I want to make sure we get through them. So are features such as verified by Visa and MasterCard secure guarantees for winning a chargeback dispute? Or are those features exposed to similar risk concerns with other 2FA models?
So if you're talking about guarantees for a merchant to win the chargeback dispute, I'm going to caution you to say that it is not an absolute 100% guarantee, because there are other errors that a merchant can make. Like I was just talking to somebody earlier this week where they did not realize until they started losing all of their chargeback disputes that they had been changed in their categorization with their MCC code to being one that was a physical goods merchant, but really they do digital services. And so their responses weren't making sense. The data they were supplying wasn't making sense. And it was because they weren't categorized correctly. So while verified by Visa and MasterCard Secure is something that if the customer participates in it, at least that should be something that greatly reduces the fraud chargeback disputes you get. You still need to look at the overall health of your payment system to make sure that there aren't any other vulnerabilities or errors that, you know, 3DS would not be able to outrank or supersede.
All right. And then the last question, how to educate customers to protect their credit card info, especially using BNPL?
And I know we're right over. Just educating them about protecting their credit card info could just come down to that idea of securing an account. I really can't separate it from securing an account and making sure that they don't reuse passwords across the internet, that they are sure that they're only, you know, transacting with legitimate merchants, that they aren't, you know, on some site that doesn't have the same protections and the same level of security on it. I know that can be a little bit difficult for some customers to ascertain though, or it might come more naturally to us in the fraud world. But yeah, I really can't separate it from account security. And when it comes to BNPL, maybe we'll just say the same thing for the veracity of the providers and for not overextending themselves, which is to me just, you know, something that's had a lot of fallout and I think is important to call out there. But we could go into more detail, but hey, maybe that's the next webinar, right, Bradley?
Yes, for sure. So I want to thank everyone for joining us. This has been an amazing, amazing event. I really think the number of questions we're getting really shows just how important it is. And thank you, Brittany, as always, for coming on with us and sharing your incredible knowledge and experience. I'll give you the last 30 seconds just to tell everyone where they can find you and Sift on the web, and then we'll sign off.
All right. Well, you can find Sift at sift.com. We are on social media as well. You can follow us on Twitter. And then for me personally, please reach out. You can also follow Sift on LinkedIn, but I am also on LinkedIn and happy to take questions and have discussions with anyone who wants to have some chats there.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Take care.